Hi, I'm Chris Cordwell, Technical Manager for Metros, and I'm here today to talk about rail noise. We're standing at Araki train station, which is just south of the Britomart train station in Auckland on the Eastern Line. Here we've done some renewals work, and we have replaced sleepers and rail and ballast to improve the infrastructure and reduce maintenance costs over time. As part of this work, we installed new rail. When you install new rail, you need to reprofile that rail so it matches the train wheels pattern to ensure good interface. To do this, we use a rail grinder, which roughs the surface and reprofiles the rail. As part of this, unfortunately, there's a period of time after the work where the rail will make a different noise because the surface of the rail is rougher. And this takes around 3 to 6 months to wear in. You can see here on the rail that there's the rusty bit and then there's the bright mark. That bright mark is the contact pattern where the rail wheel interact. The point of grinding is to allow us to move that contact band to a more central position. When rail arrives, it arrives fairly square and generic because the rail comes from a supplier that gives rail to different countries around the world that have different trains and different wheel profiles. So once we install the rail, it is standard practice to then grind the correct profile in. And that's where you see here, we've now got a silver band in more the center of the head, whereas originally, when we run in those early months, once the new rail is installed, you tend to get a shiny band on the corners of the rail in the center there, in the gauge side of the rail. So yeah, you can see here that there's some rough marks, and those marks are the grinding marks that are wearing in. When we use a big grinding train that goes through with grinding stones that spin, and that spinning stone's what wears the material away, but it also causes the roughness. And the roughness increases the friction and creates more sound. But here, as anticipated, we can now see those grinding marks are really starting to wear away. As you can see behind me, we've also got an area of the track where there's a curve. And given that trains have a straight axle and no differential, when they try and negotiate curves, one wheel has to almost go slower than the other, which it can't really do. And that imbalance is what causes rail noise on curves and causes wear on curves. We also have a future program to invest in rail lubrication, which is designed to reduce rail wheel wear, but can also have a small effect on rail noise. So this location is planned to be addressed with rail lubrication over the next 12 months because it's on a curve. And in curved areas, we want to make sure we've got the best wear and life for the rail. So there's a number of factors, environmental factors, that will increase rail noise for residents. Here at Araki, we've got the nature of the train station, which means that some trains will stop, some trains won't stop. Trains that don't stop are going faster, and a faster train makes different noises. So here on the causeway, and as part of the Auckland Metro timetable, we have a number of trains which express. That's when trains just travel through the station, don't stop, usually for positioning moves in the early morning to allow trains to be ready for the passenger services. So these trains, predominantly during the day, we're still at the end of peak here, so we've got a number of trains moving through, fairly slow. We expect their noise to probably be a little bit less. So the train's just pulling into the station here, and then we'll try and just show what happens as the train speeds up away from the station. So this will be a good example. So not only do we have rail noise caused by the rail wheel interaction, we also have rail noise caused by the train itself. So the train accelerating, the train braking, and there's also a number of factors that mean the train doesn't drive the same way every single time. The way a driver drives, like in a car, they can choose to accelerate quickly or slowly, and those noises make different sounds. So this train's accelerating away nicely. Here we can hear the sounds of the actual vehicle moving away and the traction motors. And as it moves now up to the causeway, we now switch to ringing. So that transitions then into the sound of rail noise, which is more of a ringing noise. In this location, because everything's new, it's almost like running your finger around the glass. It's very consistent, the noise is getting louder and louder and louder. Some rail noises you could hear could be clunking and banging, which is usually the sign of something we probably need to look at on track, maybe a joint, that kind of thing. But in this location, new rail, new sleepers, good ballast. Here, the causeway goes across Hobson Bay, which is connected to the Waitemata Harbour, which means it's tidal. Now, what you'll notice is that when the tide's in, the sound bounces really well across the top of the water, which means that the sound can travel further when the tide's in. Obviously works better when the water is calm. And also as today, we've got breeze blowing in from the sea, blowing towards the residence houses over here to the left-hand side. We heard the train leave the station today, and today it sounded okay. But there's also the atmospheric humidity. So when we came to look at this location in the summer, the rails were dry, not a lot of water between the two metals, the rail and the wheel. And that means the rail is a lot drier, a lot louder. Today, it's a bit more humid today. There's been rain about. The rails are probably a little bit damp in the air. And that all reduces the rail noise.